Hi, everyone. Welcome to our webinar today. We're glad that you're able to join us in the chat. If you could please introduce yourself, write your name and last name, and tell us where you're tuning in from. My name is Jervie. If you've joined us before, welcome back. If this is the first time you're joining us, we're glad to have you. Again, my name is Jervie. I'm one of the two program coordinators for the Empowering Financial Wellness Program. Joining me today is Vincenza. She's also going to be sharing a lot of organization tricks today. So you'll hear from her later. We're also joined by Christy Lynn, and she will be in the chat. If you have any questions, thoughts, anything you want to share, anything you want to ask, you can put that in the chat and she'll be moderating that. Welcome. As you all join in, we're glad to have you. This webinar is brought to you by Utah State University Extension in partnership with Utah Department of Workforce Services. So this is part two of organization tricks. Our part one was not last week, but the week before that, so March 25th. If you did not join that, if you weren't able to join that, that's okay. We'll do a quick recap as we start our webinar today. So don't feel like you're going to be doing a lot of catching up or you missed anything. We'll do a quick recap in a little bit. So what we're going to do today, you know, after you're going all through your paperwork, this webinar is part of our spring cleaning series this April. So if you haven't checked out the rest of our schedule for April, go to our website, finance.usu.edu/EFW. We have our spring cleaning series coming up this April. So check that out and register if you're interested. But like I said earlier, today we are going to talk about, you know, what to do once you have decided these are the documents I need to keep. These are the documents that needed to be tossed out. So what's next, right? So after going through all that paperwork in your drawers, deciding what to toss, what to keep, your next step is to create a system that keeps these things organized. But first, since today is officially 70% off Easter candy, we'll do a quick poll. What's your favorite Easter candy? If you can pull up your phones and scan this QR code, it will take you to this quick little poll. We're asking, what's your favorite Easter candy? Maybe you can convince us that it is the best Easter candy out there. So it will take you to a website called menti.com and just scan this QR code and it will take you to that question and you just enter your answer there. And we'll see what's on the top of the Easter candy chart. Here we go. Here's our answers. Reese's peanut butter eggs. I watched a documentary on what is it called? National Geographic about candy. And I learned that the guy who came up with Reese's peanut butter cups used to work for Mr. Hershey, who created the Hershey chocolate thing. And he was fired and he got fired, not for anything bad that he did, but I think Hershey decided that he didn't need his services anymore. But he's already come up with a formula for the peanut butter cups. So he became a competitor instead. So I thought that was interesting. And it's on the top of our poll. I'm surprised Cadbury is not the top.
So the bigger the word, the more popular it is
among our friends today attending the webinar. But there is like what, six of these here, so they're pretty equal, I guess. But There's two Cadbury cream eggs, two Reese's peanut butter chocolate. So I'm sorry, peeps. Maybe the kids like peeps. Anyway, well, thank you for participating. I hope you guys had a good Easter weekend. The weather was beautiful over the weekend. I mean, it's warm. So anyway, let's get back to business. Thank you again for participating in that fun little poll that we have. So today we will learn, well, first off, we learned that more people like Cadbury than peeps. But today we will also learn how to organize your files, your paperwork for easy access. We will also learn how to create secure storage systems, and we will learn how to stay organized. They say motivation is what gets people started, but discipline is what keeps people doing what they started. So we're gonna help you with, you know, getting there and staying there in terms of organizing your financial documents. Okay, so let's start off by, again, we're going to remind you guys, why does this matter? Of course, we want to make sure that when anything happens, if ever anything happens to you, you suddenly become ill, somebody has, you'd have to depend on others. Somebody has to manage your financial and personal affairs, that they're not going to be scrambling around, you know, figuring out where to start or where to find things. What if there's a fire or natural disaster, you need to flee, or, you know, you unexpectedly, suddenly, you know, all of a sudden you pass away. Hopefully that doesn't happen to anyone here, but what if, right? So a lot of people choose to manage their finances in a reactionary way. So something happens, it's a turning point, a light bulb comes up and, oh, I need to do this now. But that's a big financial mistake, and it can cost you a lot, especially in terms of your financial security. So if you are actively managing your finances, it will give you more peace of mind, not just you, but also for your family members. It's important to keep your financial documents together, keep them organized, because when you have this all in one place, it makes it easy for you to keep track of things, especially in these circumstances like we listed in here. So just a quick recap, these are the things that we suggest. It's really important that you keep and where you can keep them. These are items that you keep permanently. The items with one asterisk, you keep them permanently. The items with two asterisks, you keep them temporarily, or during the duration of the ownership, or as long as it's relevant to your circumstances, or until it needs to be updated. Okay, when deciding when to toss and how long you should keep them, these are just some of the standards suggested by financial counselors. You don't have to keep things forever. Tax documents is most especially is one of those myths that you have to keep them forever. You don't have to, unless, you know, there's a special circumstance or a particular incident that, you know, requires you to keep it longer than necessary. And then some of these things you really have to keep until it expires, or until you discard it or you sell it, or until it's updated. Okay, so that's just a quick recap. So also here are some of the places that you can choose from in terms of storing. You could use a safe deposit box in the bank. You can also have your own little home safe, or you can have a key drawer, like a file cabinet that has a key, or you can choose to do digital and use a cloud storage platform. There's a lot of those to choose from these days. So pro tip, okay, after our webinar last week, not last week, the week before, we've had questions about, but where do I start, right? You're looking at this pile of paper, and Vincenza is gonna talk to us about that.
Okay, so we talked about, you know, in the last slide and also last week about what documents you need to keep, how long, but you also need to think about three other things. You need to think about who's going to maintain the records, where you're going to keep the items, and when your files should be updated. So while you're sorting through paperwork, you can divide them into different categories. And this is going to help you create a new filing system if you've never done this before, or maybe just to improve what you're currently doing. So just a little pro tip, been there, done that. I found it helpful to commit to a certain time and time frame to go through the paperwork. So, you know, saying I'm going to have to spend hours going through this for some people might be discouraging and not be very motivating. But for example, let's say, okay, next Saturday, I'm going to just spend 30 minutes going through my paperwork and I get done what I get done in the 30 minutes. And then I will schedule another time to do that. For some people, that's a little bit more manageable, you know, listening to a podcast or watching something you like on TV. If you like kind of like that background distraction where you don't feel, I personally don't enjoy paperwork. I'm going to guess there are some people that don't mind it, but just whatever works to get you motivated, put on your favorite music, but just some uninterrupted time to go through. If you're just starting from beginning, start with one big pile and then just start organizing them into categories. And we're going to talk through a little bit of, you know, where do you start and how do you start breaking down that big pile? So we have some suggestions about how to sort them. You know, things that are going to require immediate action, for example, that has a time, you know, a due by date or that's super important. You're going to want to look at those and then does it need to be filed? Does it need to be acted upon or can I just toss it? And we gave you a reference document for what you should keep, what you should toss, how long, et cetera. And then you want to divide them into categories. So for example, here's an example of, you know, think about like it, whether you're doing it digitally or in paper, like these could be your file folders that you start with either digitally or again, if you actually have physical paper. And these are just some ideas for where to get started. Some of these may or may not apply to you. So you don't have, for example, if you don't own a home, you're renting, maybe you don't have certain things in that file. But if you're a renter, maybe you do have, maybe you have renter's insurance or something like that. So thinking about what's applicable to you. And of course, adding a file of if that's what you want to do. So when we talk about financial management, then you typically have, if you're doing it digitally, you could even have subfolders if you wanted to. You could get as specific as you want, you know, starting with the big file would be documents, and then you could, and we'll show you in a little bit an example of how that could be. But, you know, financial management, some examples, your bank statements, loan documents. If you have some retirement accounts, you probably put that in investments, your tax information, any insurance information. For example, keeping any insurance policies and at least one current statement of any insurance products that you have. Your estate documents would be like your wills, if you have powers of attorney, your assets and property, vital records and identification. For example, birth certificates, marriage certificates, et cetera. Employment records, for example, if you're in the military or some kind of your employment records, like your benefits, et cetera, healthcare, medical history, your medications, your doctors, your copies of your insurance cards. If you're getting immunization for COVID, you probably want to have your original card in there, or at least a copy of it. Pets, if you have pets and you want to keep their medical history, things like that. So some ideas of what you might keep in those file folders. And then after you've divided your files into categories and recorded all of your accounts, now you can lock it down. So the whole goal of doing this is to have all of this, once you have all of this newly organized information, it needs to be accessible to you or your significant other, partner, spouse, loved ones. So this is where you have to decide how you're going to file this securely. So Jeremy is going to talk to you about some options for storage systems.
Okay, so there's two ways you could do this, actually three. You could do physical system, you could do digital, or you can do both, where you back up your physical copies, you scan them. So you have this, you have the paper form in a file drawer or in a cabinet or, you know, in a safe. And then you also have a digital copy in a drive or in the cloud. So let's talk about physical systems first. Okay, it's recommended that you keep most of your important documents on paper, but this allows you to easily access them in case you don't have the internet. It happens. If you were here 2 weeks ago, I told everyone how we got a ticket for not being able to show a copy of our car insurance because I was at a dead spot. So if you have a paper copy of that in the car, if I had that, I wouldn't have to deal with an extra ticket, but we've squared that out. We figured out how to do that in a better way. But a physical system is really important for ease of access, especially if you know where they are. Okay. We'll talk about a financial binder in a little bit, because of course, if you have a lot of physical documents that you're keeping and storing and you need to flee or you need to just hand it down to another person that needs to take care of your finances or financial affairs in a situation where you cannot do it yourself, you can just say, here is my lock cabinet. You can have my lock cabinet. You can, but the easiest way to do that is to give them a binder. But we'll talk about that in a little bit. So speaking of storing your documents physically, you have to make sure that your file boxes are fireproof and waterproof. Okay, when you set up your at-home storage, choose file boxes that are waterproof and fireproof. Information like your social security card and birth certificates, those documents need to be locked. They have to be in an airtight, waterproof, fireproof container. Just in case, you know, some of these natural disasters happen, make sure that they are safe and they don't get damaged. Okay, choose a location that is dry and cool and easily accessible to you. There's no point in keeping these organized if you're not even motivated to go get them, right? If it's put away in the basement somewhere or in a very dark corner where you don't even want to go and visit it, right? Then what's the point? So make sure that you're motivated to go to that location. It has to be easily accessible to you, but not to people who you don't want to have access to these documents. So if you have a home office, that's a good place to store these things. Make sure that your home office has the door has a lock, and your cabinet, your file drawers are lockable. If you want to keep it in your master closet, you could do that as well. If it's in someplace in the basement, make sure that, you know, it's somewhere that you can easily access. Make sure that if there's some documents that are more, there's paper that's sensitive to humidity. And they can get, if the area is a little hot or warm, then it sweats. And then all of a sudden you check this document and it's smudged, then it's not valid anymore because it will come out as, what do you call it? What's the word for it? I'm coming short.
It'll look like it's a forged document.
Yeah, it could look like a forged document or something that has been tampered with. So it might invalidate that document for you. So make sure that it's in a cool, dry and cool location. Also, storage needs to be lockable, like I said earlier, whether with a key or with a keypad. Before you laminate anything, like some people would think, okay, if I laminate this, they will become more durable. Yes, that's great. But some documents you can't actually laminate because they have a seal. And when you laminate them, it actually makes it invalid because the seal can't be, you can't touch the seal. And there's a lot, some offices would actually have to look through that kind of paper. I think, what was that you mentioned last time, Vincenza, somewhere, was it in Hawaii, that paper, they have to see the paper?
Right? Yeah, in Hawaii, the insurance, proof of insurance documents happen to be printed on holographic paper, if that's the right word, because there's a high incidence of a lot of petty theft, and people steal your documents or they forge them. And so you can't just go on the computer and print it. And then you can't even show it on your phone. That's not allowed. Mm-hmm. So you have to look at your state's rules. There are some states that have more strict, but in Utah, it's acceptable, right?
Mm-hmm. So if you're worried about, you know, durability and keeping, making sure they're safe, it's better to just store them in plastic, waterproof or fireproof envelopes. I think there's a couple of those you can buy online. And then, yeah, it's just, you just have to make sure that what you're doing to keep it safe and protected will not make it invalid in the end. So then there was no point to doing that to begin with. Okay, so digital systems, a lot of our lives is dependent on, you know, electronic files. We do our banking on the phone. We can request documents via email. There's a lot of people now who are moving from physical to digital. Of course, there's still a lot of documents that we have to have the physical form, like our driver's licenses, our passports. We don't have e-passports, birth certificates, social security cards. Those things, they have to be physical, but things like your homeowner's policy, those can be downloaded. Those can be sent to you via an encrypted email from your insurance provider. So if you decide that you want a digital system instead, there's no reason why you can't recreate your physical system in your personal drive. So what you can do is to create a password protected file folder in your computer. Last time we talked about a lot of financial experts are now suggesting and encouraging people to have a separate computer, a specifically designated computer for just your documents, right? You can where you can file away all of your important documents, or an external hard drive if you want to do that, the scan and then save on an external hard drive. They're smaller. You can flee with it, right? You can use that for your backup when you scan your documents. You have your physical documents in the lockable file cabinet, and then copies of those in an external hard drive, and then you put that in the safe. You can do that as well. Another option is to use a cloud-based storage. There's a lot of these right now. What you can do is, you know, you create a folder. These are examples. This is what we call a file tree. When you do this, like Vincenzo said earlier, you can be as specific as you want, or you can be as broad as you want with your folders and subfolders and sub-subfolders, right? This is an example of how you would organize your files in Dropbox. We'll talk about that platform in a little bit, but it's up to you. You can write this out, draw this out in a piece of paper first, so that you're not confused. Oh, what kind of document will go into this folder? So for example, in this, you have this folder. You have a personal subfolder, because this is just half of a file tree. So this is personal. And then you could have here education. You put in that file copies of your transcripts, copies of your diplomas, copies of your student loan, if you want to put it there. Employers, you could put their offer letters. You could put, because sometimes when you have to, when you fill out some forms, they would ask you a history of your employment and when was that, what was that last employer information? When was my start date? So if you have that in there, that's helpful. Family, your finances could be a subfolder. It could be its own big folder with its subfolders and where you put all your financial information. So it's just up to you how you'd want to organize these. Because if it's mapped in your head, if it's mapped in your mind, then it's easy to implement when you actually do it in your computer or in a storage platform. So here's just a couple of storage platforms. You've probably heard of Amazon Drive. What is wrong with my throat today? Amazon Drive, there's OneDrive, there's Google Drive, and then there's Dropbox, there's Box. These, the basic service is free. It has a limit on storage, but just to give you just to give you, what do you call this? Just to give you reference, right? So most of these things, most of these storage options, they'd give between 2 to 15 gigabytes of storage. So just point of reference, 1 gigabyte of storage will allow you to store about 15,000 text documents, pages of text documents. So that's PDF, that's Microsoft Word. So that's a lot. So most people can go by, get by with the free versions. If you have a lot, say photos, right? Because especially high resolution ones, if you have a lot of photos, say if you're going to document every single thing in your home, which actually a lot of insurance policy providers will ask, say if there's a natural disaster and you're doing a claim, they'd ask for those things, right? If you have a lot of high resolution photos, you might need extra storage. If you find yourself needing more, you'd have to pay for those for that space, for that digital space in the cloud. And it just depends on your needs. You can pay from $1.99 a month to $120 a year, depending on how much storage you need. But again, for most people, 5 to 15 gigs is doable. With Google Drive, with the Google account, you get 15 gigs of storage, but that includes your email and then things like that. So you just have to figure out how much storage you actually need.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about creating a financial information binder. So what this is just a quick reference to your entire financial situation. And when you would have one of these completed, it's really going to help not only you, but anybody, any person that might have to manage things for you in the event that you became temporarily incapacitated or, you know, if you passed away unexpectedly. So this is a binder that should be updated annually or as things happen in your life, for example, births, deaths, marriages, divorces, or you get a new policy or whatnot. So you at a minimum, you'd want to update it at least once a year. And you'll want to store a copy of the entire notebook, again, where it's easy to grab it in the event of an emergency, or just for quick reference, you grab your binder and you go through it. For example, keeping it in a fireproof box at home, you could keep it if you didn't want to keep it on the premise, you know, in case, for example, there was a natural disaster or fire, you could keep it with a trusted friend or relative. You could keep it in a safe deposit box, but remember, safe deposit boxes are not going to have 24/7 access, right? You're going to have access to it whenever the bank is open. And then you'll want to keep the originals, just this original binder handy for you, just for ongoing, for all of your financial affairs. And what you would need to start one is pretty simple. Whatever your personal preference is, this is just an example, a 3-ring binder, get some index dividers, plastic page protectors are great too. If you want to keep documents protected or keep multiple things, just in one file folder, just for ease of location and keeping things tidy. And then you could use either notebook paper if you're not using a computer, if things aren't printed, and you could just write things down. And so what we do have is a list of some items, suggested binder items for those dividers. So here's all, and we'll share this with you in a follow-up email. You'll get a copy of this, so you'll be able to go back and reference it. But just to give you an example of the types of things that you might want to keep in your binder. I've also seen some people that keep a page protector that has just a small amount of cash in the event, you know, you had to grab that document and maybe there was a power outage and you weren't able to access an ATM. So I've seen some where they just put some small bills, just some money in there, what I thought was pretty cool idea. And so that would be a great way to just having like a go-to item, easy to grab. The hardest part I think is getting started, but once it's in there, it's just going to be like clockwork. When things get updated or they're no longer valid, you just pull it out, you toss it, shred it if it's got personally identifiable information, PII, personally identifiable information. Anytime you discard something like that, you want to make sure you shred that and then, you know, replace it with, again, if you're going to keep one of these, make sure that somebody that you trust, your spouse, your partner, or somebody that you trust, friend or family member, would know where they could find this in the event of an emergency. Okay, so that's a financial binder or a financial organizer. Then we want to talk about, okay, you did all this work. You've got all this organization done. You know what Jeremy was saying in the beginning, being motivated to do it, and then how do you stay disciplined to stay organized? So here's some ideas, you know, because the more, obviously, the more organized you are, the better it is going to be to manage your personal affairs. And in this case, we're talking about a lot of financial documents. So having a system obviously is key, but it's critical to know where documents are when you need them. So the first thing is providing access. Remember we said, who will maintain the records? Where will you keep them and when will they be updated? So number one is making sure that you provide access, knowing where the keys are, knowing where the passwords are, if you have a designated person. For example, if you choose to keep some of your items in a safe deposit box, make sure you include information in that safe deposit box about how to access your information. Maybe it's not in the safe deposit box, maybe you just have the instructions, but knowing, you know, the location of any keys, any passwords. For example, if you're going to be doing online storage, how to access the backup storage, if you just have like a removable external hard drive, you know, where do you find all this stuff? And that's important in the event you are not the one that needs to access your storage, right? And the same thing goes for a locked file cabinet or a fireproof safe in your home. Somebody would need to know, other than yourself, where you could find that. And it should maintain a list in there that explains where everything is, just so if something happens to you, again, they wouldn't be scrambling, running around. I don't know if this person has that. I don't know if they have a will. I don't know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's important that somebody has access in the event something happens to you. Making sure you're keeping things up to date. Example, maybe you can pick a date of the year. Maybe it's your birthday. Maybe it's New Year's Day, Easter. At least, you know, try to put it in your calendar and just make it a recurring event. Once a year, just go through it and make sure if there are things that need to be updated or you don't need to keep anymore. We reference that document about how long do you need to keep things. You know, you can go in there. Maybe you added new accounts since you started your binder. Just making sure it's as up to date as possible. Another thing that they recommend, financial experts recommend, is having a document locator. And this is just a list where you store your financial records. Typically, a personal document locator would have your personal information, personal context. For example, if you have somebody that does your taxes, if you have a family attorney, if you have a financial advisor, you would just put the information of who they are and how they can be contacted. Any online accounts with username and passwords. Just because somebody passes away doesn't mean a family member doesn't mean you automatically have the right to ask. For example, let's say it's Google Mail. You don't necessarily have the right to get their password from the provider. And then of course, list the specific locations of any important documents. And that could be like in a home office or a safe, things like that. Scheduling and sorting and purging. Those are scheduled sorting and purging. Again, setting aside time, you said at least once a year. Maybe you like to do it once a month, or for sure when some life event happens, death, birth, adoption, you get a new job, et cetera. So you should sort it often because you don't want to pile up of documents. And it can be discouraging if you're, again, staring at a pile of documents. So, and one way to prevent that buildup of documents in your inbox, just think about out with the old, in with the new. So if you get a new document and you have an old one, just immediately take that old one out, replace it with the new one. For example, if you have like a new insurance policy, or you can also just scan, you know, go in your computer, scan the new document and go in and delete the old one. If you get any annual statements, sometimes you'll get quarterly statements. But once you get an annual statement for that particular policy or account, you can go ahead and discard all of the quarterly statements and just keep that yearly statement. Just a way to minimize how much paper we're handling, because the less times you have to handle something, you know, the better. That's the whole point. And we talked about that it's important to purge your files at least annually, if not more often, but at a minimum, we're talking at least once a year. Okay, moving on. Jeremy, do we have anything else you want to add to?
Yeah. Why is this moving on its own? Okay. Yeah. So I think the biggest takeaway here is you don't want to do all that work and then have to do it, go back to square one and have to do it over again, because the paperwork has piled up again. In my house, I have this, little command center is what I call it. And I have a little, I should have taken a picture, but it's in my dining area. It's one of our nooks in the dining area, and it's my little command center. And when the mail comes in, right, we get it from the mailbox and we put it in this one physical inbox. And then that's where you start this sorting process. Where was that? Where did it go? There for immediate action. That's where you get all your junk, all the important stuff. And then you say, okay, this is a bill. Say if you're still receiving, you know, paper bills, this is a bill. Do I work on it now? Right? Or have I already paid it? If you've already paid it, you can shred it, right? Toss it. Or if you want to keep it for your files, you can file it, right? So that's why it's important to purge often, so that the pile don't build up, because that's where the mess and the clutter and the stress comes in. And we don't want that to happen. Because then you go back to square one and do it over again, and you get demotivated and unmotivated, and you're like, I don't want to do this anymore. It's not working. The binder, like Vincenzo said, we're going to send you a copy of the suggested binder items and how to actually start a binder in the follow-up email. It's your grab and go or pass it on when it needs to be done that way. It's just easy access. Like I said, if you have multiple file folders, all of the things are in there, but the important things, the most important things that you could just grab and go or give to another person if you cannot do it yourself anymore, that's where the treasure is, right? That's the word I've been thinking of this whole time. But if you have any questions that we haven't answered yet, I think we had a question earlier, which I think Amber asked, storing each sheet in a sheet protector, does that help with cross-contamination or smudging or sweat? Christy had a great answer for that. The sheet protector could be enough, but if you just want to be safe, better safe than sorry. You can put that in a fireproof or waterproof container. Catherine, yes, we will share our slides with you. We will send a recording of this webinar. We will also send a PDF copy of the presentation. And we will also send you that list of documents that you can with that information about how long you should keep them or how you should keep them and where you should keep them. Other questions that we can answer today?
I just had a comment, Jervy.
Yeah.
You know, just one of the points the whole point of being organized financially and having these documents, you know, a lot of these documents can be replaced, right? If you lose your Social Security card, if you lose your marriage certificate or whatnot, it's just the convenience, because a lot of times people need to access these things in times of emergency, or you need them quickly. So it's not to say that they could never be replaced, but it's the convenience of having it there when you need it, right? So it's not to say it's an end all if you don't have these things done. It's just going to make your life easier, less stressful. And in the event there was an unforeseen, you know, thing that happened in your life, it's just one less thing that you'd have to worry about. Because usually when you're dealing with things to do with finances and family and emergencies, and you're so stressed about other things, that this is just one thing that can help you and give you peace, you know, financial peace of mind, knowing that I've got everything organized. And if somebody needed to just grab that or know where to find it, would just make everything a lot easier for you. So that's really the whole point of this, is making things easier for you.
One less thing to think about, right?
Right. So you can focus on the real emergency, right? Or the real issue at hand that you're trying to sort through.
Yes. Yes. Yes, 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 and yes to all of those things. like we said, April is, well, did I mention that yet? April is Financial Literacy Month. So we're kicking off this month actually with this webinar. Right in time for spring. On our drive home the other day, my kid said, "Why is it spring cleaning? Can we clean other days?" I'm like, "Glad you asked. I've been asking you to clean all year." but we thought that with kickoff, April with Financial Literacy Month, and April with the idea of spring cleaning with this webinar, and, you know, give you an idea where you can start, whether it's outside with your yard or with your garden beds, or inside with your documents and your paperwork. This is one of the things that you can decide to work on, and hopefully that we've given you information that will help you, that will motivate you to start on organizing your finances and all the important paperwork that's pertinent to your life, wherever you are in your financial journey right now. We would love to know what you think of our webinars. If you can go to this link or scan this QR code, it will take you directly to a survey. Please let us know how we can improve our webinars. We'd love to know what you plan to do as a result of this webinar, as a result of what you learned from our webinars. You will also be entered for a drawing. We just picked our March winner. So that winner will hear from us in the next few days. So at the end of April, we'll pick another one of our participants who completes our survey. If you are not following us yet on social media, we are on Facebook, Instagram, we are on YouTube, at Utah Money Moms. You can also join us on the blog, utahmoneymoms.com. We have a lot of, especially this month, because it's Financial Literacy Month, we have a lot of insights and tips and tricks that we're sharing on the blog right now. And if you subscribe and you follow us, then you'll get all these updates from us. If you want to register for more of our webinars or host a free class for your community, especially if you're from Utah, go to finance.usu.edu/EFW, and we have all those information there for you. Thanks for joining us today. We hope that this has been a great experience for you. We hope to see you again soon. Thank you, everybody. Have a great day.